Next, we take up performance of IC engines. Performance of IC engines. Now, whichever firm manufactures IC engines, they conduct test on each and every engine which is manufactured and measure their performance. That is how it is performing. For that, we conduct test. So there will be a lab in every factory, every firm which produces IC engines, like maybe Tata's, maybe Ashok Leyland's, whichever company, they are, whoever is producing these automobiles, they are all producing IC engines, and everybody in these factories, if you go, they will have a lab called heat engine lab, where these engines are subjected to tests and their performance is measured. Now, what is it that we test? What is it that we find out by conducting these tests? These are, in these tests, we find out these things: indicated power, or it is called IP shortly, brake power, BP, friction power, FP, mechanical efficiency, indicated thermal efficiency, or it is simply called thermal efficiency also. If you say simply thermal efficiency, it is the indicated thermal efficiency. The brake thermal efficiency, brake thermal efficiency, it is also called as overall efficiency of the engine. Then relative efficiency, or it is also called as the efficiency ratio. Then specific fuel consumption, SFC, on IP and BP basis. Then we also do heat balance sheet, heat balance sheet for the test. A heat balance sheet is drawn for the test on minute basis. So these are the things which we find out, which we calculate, which we determine when a test is conducted on an IC engine. Now let us see what these things are. First, before we conduct a test, let us find out what are these quantities. See, power, first we'll take up indicated power. Power, we know, is defined as the rate of doing work, and the first part which moves in an IC engine, as you know, is the piston. It is the piston which moves. The gases exert pressure on the piston and make the piston move. So this is the first part which moves, right? So due to the pressure exerted by the gases, the piston moves. At what rate the work is developed here? That is called as the IP, or indicated power of the engine. It is the power developed at the piston, or you can also say inside the cylinder, at the piston of an IC engine. It is given by the relationship. It is given by the relationship IP is equal to PM L A N, it makes plan, divided by 60 for one cylinder. This will be the IP of one cylinder. If it is a multi-cylinder engine, each cylinder will be giving this into number of cylinders K. So this will give you, this formula will give you the IP in kilowatts. In this formula, PM stands for mean effective or indicated mean effective pressure. To be precise, it can be, it is called as indicated mean effective pressure, indicated mean effective pressure, effective pressure. It is shortly called as MEP, indicated mean effective pressure, exerted by the gases on the piston in kilopascal or kilonewton per square meter. 1 kilopascal is nothing but 1 kilonewton per square meter. Now this may be directly given. If it is directly given, well and good. The units, you must be very careful about the units. Here it should be substituted in kilopascal only. If it is in some other unit, generally it can be given in bar. If it is given in bar, then you have to multiply it by 100, convert it into kilopascal, and then substitute it here. If it is not directly given, it will be, it can be calculated using this formula. Area of indicator diagram, this will be given. Indicator diagram, usually in square mm, divided by length of indicator diagram, indicator diagram, it will be in mm, so this ratio will be in mm, multiplied by spring scale or spring stiffness, they say, or spring constant, they say, something like that, spring constant. It will be in bar per mm. So this will give us the mean effective pressure in bar, and then we can convert it into kilopascal by multiplying it by 100. Now what is this indicator diagram? Indicator diagram is nothing but the PV diagram, actual PV diagram drawn for this, for the engine. Now to draw this PV diagram or indicator diagram, we use a mechanism called indicator mechanism. It will be attached to the piston. As the piston moves forward and backwards, a indicator, a pen will be drawing this graph on a graph sheet to some scale. So this diagram is called as indicator diagram. This is its area. It is used, it is measured by using a planimeter, an instrument called planimeter. Then length of indicator diagram into, we use a spring to draw it to some scale. That spring constant, if you multiply, you will get the mean effective pressure. So this is PM. L stands for stroke length. That is, I told you, stroke length means the length, that is the distance between top dead center and bottom dead center of a engine cylinder. that is called as the stroke length. This should be in meters. In meters, this should be substituted in meters. A is area of cylinder. Area of cylinder in square meters. This will be not directly given. This we will have to calculate generally by using the formula pi d square by 4. Here d is the dia of the cylinder of the engine. Right, that will be, that you must put in meters. D is dia of cylinder, or it is also called as bore. Bore in meters. In meters, that is A. N is, small n is number of explosions. Explosions per minute, that is number of time the fuel is ignited inside the cylinder in 1 minute. So number of explosions per minute. Now this will be, this N will be same as N if it is a two-stroke engine. Two-stroke engine, then N will be same as N. If it is four-stroke engine, N will be capital N by 2. If it is four-stroke engine, here this capital N is the speed of the crankshaft, the speed of the engine in RPM. So in two-stroke engine, in every revolution, there will be one explosion, one this thing. If it is a four-stroke engine, there will be half the number of this thing. So if the number of explosions are directly given, in some problem it may be given directly that they have counted how many explosions took place. Then if it is directly given, we need not bother whether it is two-stroke engine or four-stroke engine. But generally, the capital N will be given. In that case, when we are calculating the indicated power, we should be careful as to note whether it is a two-stroke engine or a four-stroke engine. Now, this gives the IP of one cylinder. If it is a multi-cylinder engine, this K is number of cylinders. K is number of cylinders. If it is single cylinder, it will be one, or you can leave it. Now, this is plan. Easy to remember, plan. And when you multiply this, see, this is in kilonewton per square meter. This is in meter. This is in meter square. This is explosions per minute. So what happens here is you are getting the work done in kilonewton per square meter, or it is kilonewton meter in per minute, kilojoule per minute. Now 60 kilojoules per minute is 1 kilowatt. 1 kilowatt is defined as 60 kilojoules of heat per minute, or 60 kilonewton meter of work per minute. So by dividing this by 60, we are converting it into kilowatts. Right. So this is the formula for IP of a IC engine. Next, we will take up the second one, the BP or brake power. Second, brake power. See, the power that we develop here, that is developed here, cannot be consumed there only. It has to be transmitted to the crankshaft. Whatever power that is available at the crankshaft, we can use it. We cannot use the power or consume the power inside the cylinder. So it has to be transmitted there, transmitted to this point. What is available here, that is called as the brake power. It is the power available at the crankshaft. at the crankshaft of an IC engine. That is called as the brake power. Now it is always, BP is always less than IP. It can never be greater than IP. In an ideal engine where there are no losses, at best BP can be equal to IP. It can never be more than IP, because at every joint here there will be some losses during transmission. So what reaches the crankshaft will be always less than what is developed at the piston. So you must keep this in mind, that BP can never be more than IP. It should always be less than IP. And it is calculated, BP is calculated using the formula BP is equal to 2 pi NT by 60. Here, so many kilowatts. Here, we need not bother what type of engine, whether it is two stroke or four stroke. We need not bother. It is capital N here. N is speed of engine in RPM. There also capital N stands for speed in RPM. Here also it stands for speed of the engine in RPM. Next, T is brake torque. Brake torque in kilonewton meter. This is sometimes directly given. If it is directly given, no problem, you can put it there. Now, in practical, this brake torque is measured by using a device called dynamometer, which is mounted on the crankshaft of the engine. Right, we use a dynamometer. Now, your syllabus says very specifically rope brake dynamometer. There are different types of dynamometers. The syllabus says very clearly that it should be rope brake dynamometer. A rope brake dynamometer means, suppose this is the crankshaft of the engine. This is the crankshaft. Now, on this crankshaft, we key a wheel. This wheel is called as the brake wheel or brake drum. They call that as brake drum or brake wheel. And they pass a rope around this wheel. A rope is passed like this. Here you will have a spring balance, and this will be suspended from a hook. On this side, this end of this thing, we put the dead weight. You can adjust those dead weights. This will be acting. It is subjected to a pull like this. Opposite forces will be acting. The force will be acting this side here. It will be acting this side. This is S. This will be always less than W. So the net tangential force on the brake drum will be W minus S kilonewtons. That multiplied by the radius, mean radius of the brake drum, gives me the torque, brake torque. If torque is not directly given, they will give all these things. So this will be W minus S into R, so many kilonewtons, kilonewton meters. Now here W is dead weight on the brake drum, on brake drum, in kilonewton. S is spring balance reading. In kilonewton, or they can directly give W minus S also. This is called net brake load. Net brake load on the brake drum, on brake drum, in kilonewton. R is the mean effective radius. Mean effective radius of brake drum in meters. Now this mean effective radius means they can give the diameter of the wheel and diameter of the rope. Then it will be diameter of the wheel plus dia of the rope divided by 2. If dia of rope is not given, you have to take it as neglected and we have to take it. So they can ask what is a rope brake dynamometer also. Rope brake dynamometer, a dynamometer is nothing but a device used for finding out the torque, brake torque. Okay, there are different types. They specifically have said it is rope brake dynamometer. Next, third one is the friction power or FP. Now, this is nothing but the power lost. The power lost mainly due to friction. There may be other small reasons, but we cannot find out all of them very clearly. The most biggest loss will be the loss due to friction. It is the power lost mostly due to friction between these two places, that is during transmission from piston to crankshaft. So mathematically this FP will be equal to IP minus BP. It is the difference between IP and BP. Now I said I gave you the formula for IP and BP. Sometimes they may give FP also. So one of them, if you know FP and if you know any one of these two, the other one can be found out from here also. It is not necessary that always you should find out IP only by that formula or BP only by that formula. They can be found out from here also if FP is given. Next, fourth one is mechanical efficiency. This is defined as the measure of what part of IP developed at the piston reaches the crankshaft in the form of BP. That is, how much, what portion of IP is reaching in the form of BP at the crankshaft. Now, mathematically, this mechanical efficiency is the ratio of BP to IP. Now, because this is lesser than IP, the value of this will be always less than 1. It will be always less than 1 because numerator is smaller and denominator is bigger. And this is generally given as percentage. So if you multiply whatever number you get, if you multiply that by 100, you will get it in percentage. Now, BP or IP can be got from here also. If mechanical efficiency is given, IP is given, you can get BP, or mechanical efficiency and BP are given, you can find IP from here also. So there is no hard and fast rule that is the formula for BP and this is the formula for IP. Not like that. It depends upon the given data in the problem. Next, fifth one is indicated thermal efficiency. Fifth one, indicated thermal efficiency, or it is also called as simply thermal efficiency. If they say simply thermal efficiency, it is this efficiency, eta I. It is a measure of what part of heat that we gave to it in the form of fuel, how much part of it we got back in the form of IP, indicated power. So if you get indicated thermal efficiency as 30%. The meaning is 30% of the heat that we gave to the engine, we got back in the form of IP. That is, if you have purchased 100 rupees fuel, you have got 30 rupees worth of IP from that. So it is calculated using the formula indicated thermal efficiency is equal to IP into 60 divided by MF into CV. So whatever IP we have calculated, that will be substituted here, divided by this. Again, if you want to give it as percentage, into 100. So here MF stands for mass of fuel supplied or consumed by the engine in kg per minute. In 1 minute, how much fuel we are giving, that is MF. CV is calorific value or heating value of the fuel used, calorific value of fuel in kilojoule per kg. Kilojoule per kg. If CV, if it is a gas engine, if CV is given in cubic meter per kg, kilojoules per cubic meter, then instead of mass, you can use volume in cubic meters per minute, volume of gaseous fuel used. Next, sixth one is brake thermal efficiency or overall efficiency. This is nothing but same as this. What part of heat we supplied, we are getting back in the form of BP it is. So it will be BP into 60. Instead of IP, you get BP divided by MF into CV. This will give you the brake thermal efficiency, or it is also called as overall efficiency. If you multiply it by 100, it becomes percentage. I hope you are understanding this, brake thermal efficiency. Then seventh one is relative efficiency, or efficiency ratio. It is also called as efficiency ratio. Here it is a comparison between, relative efficiency is the comparison between actual thermal efficiency. Actual thermal efficiency means indicated thermal efficiency, which we got from the formula above. Actual thermal efficiency to theoretical thermal efficiency. Theoretical thermal efficiency means the air standard of the cycle, thermodynamic cycle on which it is working. If it is a petrol engine, the problem says petrol engine, then you must use the formula for petrol engine, that is auto cycle. It will be working on auto cycle. If it is a diesel engine, then you have to use the formula of diesel cycle to calculate the air standard efficiency. So relative efficiency will be ratio of theoretical thermal actual thermal efficiency, that is indicated thermal efficiency, to the theoretical thermal efficiency. Theoretical thermal efficiency is the air standard efficiency of the cycle on which it is working. If you want it in percentage, again into 100. So this is relative efficiency. Next is SFC, specific fuel consumption. This can be done on two bases. SFC on IP basis means then fuel consumed in 1 hour, that is MF into CV divided by the actual IP developed by the engine, so many kg per IP hour. To produce one IP per every hour, it consumes so much power, so much fuel. That is called as the specific fuel consumption. SFC on BP basis means, it can be done on BP basis also. Here, instead of IP, it will be BP, and the unit will be kg per BP hour. Then we will draw a heat balance sheet. Now, heat balance sheet means it is a statement, mathematical statement. Heat balance sheet is a mathematical statement which indicates how the heat came into the engine and how it is spent. Like a financial balance sheet prepared by these companies, you know, every year they prepare this thing and give it to the shareholders, all companies, a balance sheet where they will show how the money came, from where the money came and how that money was spent. That a statement will be given, similar statement. The financial balance sheet will be done on 1 year basis, one financial year basis. This generally is done on minute basis. Now here there will be two columns. One side it is supply, on the other side it is the expenditure, that is expenditure that is of heat, not of money. Here it will be in kilojoules per minute. Sometimes they can ask on percentage basis also, whatever it is, kilojoules per minute. If they have asked, you will have to do it. One, heat supplied. Only one source of heat is there, that is by burning the fuel. This side you have heat converted to BP or converted to work, useful work, heat carried away by cooling water, heat carried away by, generally these are the things, whereby exhaust gases, that is gases going out of the engine. And fifth one, heat unaccounted, that is we cannot give correct account of this, that is the heat loss due to friction, radiation, etc. So these things will be plotted here, and then the total on both sides agrees. The total, it will naturally agree, because this heat unaccounted will be this, whatever we have here, minus the total of these three will give you the heat unaccounted. So the total in both the cases, the total will be the same. Here and here it will agree. So this is how heat balance sheet is done. Now these are calculated. Further, when I am doing numericals, we will see how it is to be calculated, right, how these are to be calculated. So these are the things that we have to do in performance of IC engines. Thank you. Please subscribe and share.